This is going to be part 9 of The World of Tomorrow Today. I'm going to give a couple of different concepts and points of view and bounce around a little bit as I always do. And I usually give some predictive type of things by just my conversation. I was talking about supermarkets. Now, my local supermarket is actually a variety store. I started saying that in the other tape. The other video, but I go over to my supermarket and it has socks, it sells toasters, it sells glasses, it sells coffee makers, it sells batteries for flashlights, it sells cell phone wires and chargers and toothpaste and pharmaceuticals. It has a coffee shop. And there's a shop at home service where they'll shop for you and deliver the food to your house for another $10, more than the price of the food, and so forth. And actually, the modern supermarket is also a variety store. It's as much a variety store as a Woolworth used to be. You can buy shoelaces or shoe shine stuff or socks or underwear. Cups, glasses, silverware—all in your supermarket, and it's amazing that they sell a variety of stuff. You could buy a toaster, a microwave, a toaster oven, a coffee maker, whatever. Right, in my supermarket, my local supermarket. I wanted to get back to another period of time. I remember when I was a child, the TVs were real small, and they would be in a piece of furniture. And the major person on TV at that time was who they called Uncle Milty, which was Milton Buryl. And it was a little black and white set. The picture tube was about the size of a toilet seat, and it was in a big 600-pound piece of furniture. And at that time, too, Eisenhower was the president. It was the very early 50s. And his promise to the people was that there would be peace in our lifetime. And I was thinking back that there has never been peace in our lifetime. There's been either the Korean War or Iran or Iraq Israel war going on or Afghanistan and North Korea, the Korean War, and so forth and so on. So peace is one thing we haven't yet achieved. And what Eisenhower warned in his closing address after being president, because he was the head of the Allied forces during World War II, and Truman was the president when the atomic bomb got dropped. And I was born right after the war. And I saw Eisenhower on TV, in fact. It was a small black and white TV. And he said he campaigned on there'll be peace in our lifetime, because that was a big deal with people right after World War II. And he warned about the military industrial complex, about the buildup of weapons and nuclear weapons and missiles and this kind of thing. And the stockpiling of weapons and the weapons companies that kept on selling weapons to all countries and this kind of thing. And in a way, that is one of our major expenses and has always been the military and the buildup of military. So I won't even question whether it's good or bad or how worthy it is, but it's just something to keep in mind, that the military-industrial complex, the influence it has on our government, the various companies that build and sell weapons, and the stockpile of weapons we have. And there was a question, again, looking at Iraq, that they had weapons of mass destruction, which they didn't have, and how we went into Afghanistan and Iraq. And of course, I spoke about the bailouts of the banks and the bust for the housing bust. And I thought the bailout and the housing bust was all conceived. I don't really think it was a. I thought they were lying when they said it. I'll be honest with you. That was my first impression. Another thing I wanted to say was that TVs have changed. When cable first came in, the promise of the cable people was, and how they sold it to the American people, was that you wouldn't have to listen to commercials and sit and hear boring commercials. So if you bought and paid for TV, you would have pure TV and special channels, and you wouldn't have to sit through boring commercials. Well, today they charge you for the TV, you sit through boring commercials, and it's overcapitalized. So the promises that they made, cable today is like another utility. It's like your electric, your water, your telephone. It's another utility bill. And they made promises, no commercials at the time, but the young people don't remember that. Now, Milton Buryl, like I said, was a major, he was called Mr. TV at the time, going back to the 50s, and they gave him a lifetime contract for $100,000 a year for life so that nobody else should get him. They never thought that and after a while he would kind of like burn out and other people would come into the picture, other stars, you know, like Johnny Carson, whatever. Milton, you know, Merv Griffin and so forth. And Sammy Davis Jr. and a lot of other people that, you know, they came into being in popularity. So it's interesting how times have changed. The old TVs weighed, like I said, they were like a 600-pound piece of furniture, and they had a very small black and white set. People really didn't have color TV. It wasn't really in circulation or really developed at that time. And today you could buy a TV, you get this huge screen TV and it weighs 3 or 4 pounds. And if you turn it sideways, the whole picture is like an inch and a half wide. And you have this beautiful high definition picture going at the same time. Now, I was talking about medical care, and a lot of people, they look at the TV and they hear about them wanting to kick like 25 or so million people off health care and will worry about it later. And they figure that the politicians really don't understand what they're doing to people. Well, I hate to say it, they do understand it. Say, well, gee, do they really understand it? They just don't care. And that's the hardest thing for people to understand, is that they really don't care. They're robot-like people. Just look at their eyes, as I say. You can see that they don't care at all. Now, when they or them or their family get sick, they want them to have the finest medical care in the world. And the way they hide it is they have a beautiful statement. And the statement is that they should buy medical care in a marketplace in accordance with what they can afford. And what they're really saying is poor people won't be able to get very much, and they won't get good medical care because they really can't afford it. But they're trying to make it sound fairer than it is, saying, well, you could buy it in a marketplace according to what you can afford. It sounds fair, but really to disabled people, to poor people, to people with health conditions, pre-existing conditions, it's very unfair. It's really a death sentence. And they do it without even blinking, so I call them robot-like people.